identify items of note, items that have been escalated from the bi-monthly report to Seacombe, provide performance data relating to the delivery of the internal service, identifies some developments that have taken place within the service. Your attention is specifically drawn to section 3.2, page 12 of the report, where a number of items are identified for your noting. The first one relates to previous discussions that have taken place at this committee regarding the lack of progress by officers at that time in addressing a number of outstanding audit recommendations relating to the resource system. Significant amount of follow-up has been undertaken by us since we last met back in November. All of the actions that were required by officers have now been fully implemented. We have undertaken various assurance away, including some testing, some very detailed testing within those systems, and I'm very pleased to report that, as I say, all the recommendations have now been addressed. Further audit work will be conducted by us in the new year, with scheduled some for early 2017-18 to verify the effectiveness of the new arrangements that have gone in place, make sure that we're working as we would hope to be able to be working, and that the controls are continuing to be submitted to an action as such. And I'll report the outcome of that to this committee, but it is pleasing because the actions identified against this particular piece of work have been outstanding for quite a considerable period of time, so it is good progress. The second item that I wanted to bring to your attention, 2.2b, relates to the piece of work in the sort of business rates valuations. We've undertaken a piece of work to determine whether or not the controls within the valuation system provide assurance that the operating data is accurate, is reliable, and focused on the key risk areas. We did identify a number of actions for management to improve existing systems, but none of these were of a significant or material nature, and certainly didn't present us with significant control failures. We have agreed an action plan with members, with officers, and we will be undertaking full work again over the next couple of months, and we'll report back on the findings of those actions. Attention is also drawn to section 3.3 on page 13 of the report, where a table identifying information relating to those audits where recommended actions include an audit report that remain outstanding. The table as attached again shows significant progress having been made since previous attachments were provided to yourselves. We did discuss this in some detail and some minor tweaks have been made to the actual presentation of that report to try to accommodate some of the comments made by the members. All of the entries that currently exist on that report at the moment relate to audits that have been undertaken within IES, our subject of a separate development report by the Chief Information Officer to this committee later this evening. He will identify what has been made within this particular area of operations and provide you hopefully with the assurances that you require in relation to some of the risks we presented. Section 3.4, page 14 of the report, I identify information relating to the performance of the internal service. You will note that delivery of the audit plan is still slightly below target due to some previously reported recruitment retention problems that I've experienced during the year to date. Progress has been made to address those problems. Two recent staffing appointments have been made and are in the process of helping me to, by and large, address those sort of shortfalls. I do anticipate that the coming year end will be very close to full achievement of that plan. I certainly don't think there's any cause for concern, and I'm happy with the way the result is. Feedback from clients and management remains very good. All the key actions identified in all reports have been agreed. Client satisfaction levels remain high, which I'm very pleased about. Section 3.5 on page 14 of the report identifies some of the continuing improvements that have been made to improve the service. I've included just to keep you abreast of some of the things that we're sort of casting our mind to and looking at in the future, constantly trying to sort of improve how we deliver the service.
the annual funding statement update. Are the committees ago, you started bringing Mr. Paul's as regular updates to the committee town list. Well, the annual government statement coming once a year or twice a year is to keep you informed of what's happening in between. The report we brought last time was just a general overview of our process, and since then we've had a further update regarding the internal office of corporate governance group has met, and in there is a series of actions on looking at the key issues that were highlighted in the government statement at the end of 2015-16. You know, there's two parts of performance around the compliance generally, and we've picked some of the issues like performance appraisal, signals, training and monitoring, that sort of part of things. And the other issue we came up was the Ofsted report, which came out very late in the day in September to inform the government statements at that stage. This report was the first one. It gives you quite the detail, and the appendix shows the detail that goes to the corporate governance group. At this stage, we're giving you everything that went to the corporate governance group. Whether members want that sufficient level of detail or want less detail, you can say any comments on that. But this is could give you the detail and confidence you need to be assured that the work is being taken forward in these areas. So when we do the government statement for 16-17, which you think the process will be coming to you in March 18, and the report itself will be in June, it gives you the chance to be informed about what's outstanding in 2015-16 and confidence that those actions are being taken. Rather than going through the detail, I'm happy to take any comments, but the report is essentially the motive.
Thank you, Tom. Excellent report with no reds. Christina?
I don't want to let the bullet appraisals go on this one, Tom, please, because we're now coming towards the end of the year, so you would expect it to be a higher bill, wouldn't you, because it starts out at nothing. There's two questions. First of all, I asked Mr. Name I've forgotten, Blott. I asked Mr. Blott on a number of occasions, but never really understood the answer, because I'm fake, as to why you always start with the same people and go through the process rather than looking at the people who haven't been appraised and starting the next year with them. I'm sure there's a very good reason why, but in my totally logical mind, I would think you'd swap up the people who've never been done. But looking at it, as I've always thought, and I've kind of hinted at, you can see now where the gaps are in all this. And I still don't feel that we're actually reaching any sort of agreement that staff appraisals have to be done. I think we've reached the point where people are fed up with us councillors fighting on about it, but I kind of still don't think that there's a generally accepted view that people need to be appraised. And I'm just wondering, why does nobody's looked at the way you do that program? Okay?
In terms of where do we start from, all staff should have an appraisal every year. That's the premise we work from. It starts with the managers. The managers are the first ones to have an appraisal, so there's the cascade effect. This year, we made significant progress compared to last year. There's still some way to go, but look at that, 90% of staff have been done. There's some issues around children's services, which the deadline for those are extended to the end of March. Because staff within that area, it's supervision and performance appraisal seems something different from that. So there's been a bit of confusion over that one. But in terms of where we are, they've been given to the end of March to do all the appraisals for this year. In terms of rest of staff, we're looking at 90% across the piece, and 97% of managers. What it does highlight there is sort of the area of transformation. Few staff in that area, so it stands out, it looks like a significant drop, but there's only like four staff and managers with 300 appraised. When the staff took the pilots, we initially said that all staff would have an appraisal by the 30th of September. The way the statistics are working now, it's picking up all staff, so there'll be staff in those schedules that would have an appraisal. We joined in October that have had an appraisal since. So it's a live percentage all the time. I think that's one thing we perhaps need to learn the next time is how do we find that. So when we say all staff who are here in September, and that should be the cut-off. Because I know Mr. Mark has when he started in September, did he have the appraisal when he started on the 29th, having the appraisal by the 30th. And similarly in the transformation team, some of the people there have specifically around the Information Commissioner's audit that took place last year. So on the disaster recovery and business continuity front, as members will know, we've been working for the last couple of years to remediate the risk posed by the fact that both our data pools are in one building, i.e. the Treasury building or, and the annex. At the last update, you should have been told that we've signed a contract with Mersey Travel. Mersey Travel have, since signed that contract, they have undertaken certain capital work to extend their data hall to make the space ready for us. We have then also gone out to procurement and just completed a contract for a specialist cabling company to link our fibre network that runs around the Birkenhead area with the fibre network that Mersey Travel's fibre network through the Birkenhead tunnel, and that has been completed and tested and commissioned. We are currently finalising design work with a specialist partner to put the design together for the network equipment that needs to go either end of that fibre network. So what do we need to put in the Treasury building to the data pool we will retain, and what network equipment has to go into the data centre, Mersey Travel data centre in George's Dock in Liverpool. That work, the report should be finished at the end of this month, and work to build that network out will start immediately after that. We already have the procurement vehicle in place to just go and buy that equipment off the shelf. And at the same time, we are going out to procurement to identify specialist project management company that specialises in moving, safely moving IT equipment from one location to another, so that they can advise us on the best way to minimise any risk of any loss of service during the move from the Treasury building across to George's Dock, and to then take the risk around recommissioning the equipment at the other end. So they should have all the proper insurance policies in place and the technical expertise to help us to effect that move in the most timely manner. Our current plan sees that rolling out so that we should be up and running and live by September time of this year. Once that has gone live, that corporate risk can be seen to be mitigated. We will have good resilience across the network, two data centres in entirely different locations. The risk of losing service will be minimised as far as we can within reason. But it will not stop us from continuing to look at that. And every new system that we implement will be identified whether the most effective way of retaining that resilience. So if we're gonna, if new systems come in and are designed to be on premise or to hold them ourselves, they will be designed so that part of them will be in Birkenhead and part of them will be in Liverpool. Increasingly, you'll have heard that organisations and local government in particular now looking to put stuff out in the cloud. That just really means, from our perspective, is we don't hold servers, somebody else does. They take the risk, they provide us with the assurance and the resilience, and all we do is we pay them a fee. And it wraps up the whole of the system with that, all of the infrastructure piece, but it's part of business as usual. So it's really part of looking at resilience in the round. Moving on then to look at the data loss prevention audit. We look at that, and there's been the risks. If I just go and refer to the report and the recommendations, the expand a bit about the information governance update as well. A number of them are up for renewal and review, but we have, as part of our action plan to satisfy the Information Commissioner, before May, all of our information policies, whether they be information governance, information security, data loss prevention, all of those things fall under that one banner. They will all be reviewed and updated before the Information Commissioner comes back to do a review of our progress in May. And then in terms of the technical solutions that we have in place, we had an update from my colleague Phil Moss, who left us recently. Our technical data loss prevention solution gives us, we have a thing called McAfee's data loss prevention endpoint that we use. This basically allows us to control who has access to copying information off the network through their PC. So, as standard, nobody has the right to use the USB stick ports on their PCs. We do not have any PCs now with DVD drives, DVD burner drives. Anybody that has a business case to use one of those devices has to go through a process of getting approval from the right level of management up at the director or head of service level. We log and we periodically review their requirement, and it will be taken away when it's, if it's not needed. All of those devices as well, if they have been given permission to use them and the device and the ports have been opened and are enabled, they are enabled in such a way that the device that they use, whether it's a USB stick or a DVD drive or whatever it might be, has to be encrypted. So if they're copying particularly sensitive information onto the USB stick to take it out of the council for any particular reason, then that device will be encrypted, that data will be safe, and if the worst happens and they lose that device, then we are reasonably assured, as well as we can be, that the data will not be accessible because of the level of encryption that is part of inherent within the system. The next stage beyond that would be to go to ask the business to classify all of their information and then put a technical solution in around that. But that is, at the moment, the risk is about getting stuff out of the council on data sticks and DVD drives, and that is covered now. And again, with the policy is part of the policy. It says here there should be a data loss prevention policy. That policy, although not called data loss prevention policy, is covered within our wider information governance and information security policies. And it will be that will be reviewed and updated before May. On the cybersecurity audit, a number of recommendations there that have been made by auditors who visited us from Salford Council. All the recommendations were agreed and form part of an action plan which will be delivered by May in line with the Information Commissioner's audit as well. A lot of these things overlap. And recommendations were made that were part of, were found by the Information Commissioner as well. And I think finally, just as a general point on the general information government. And we've got better scrutiny, both within the officer scrutiny and within members, in that the information governance delivery group reports into the corporate governance group, and also regularly briefs the member in charge of transformation and governance. So at the moment, Councillor Anna Grappling, and also I would expect would come and bring regular updates because of the risk to this committee as well. And the other thing that we're looking at, beyond the Information Commissioner's Audit Action Plan, is planning is well underway now to get ourselves ready for the implementation of the General Data Protection Regulations, the new European Union regulations that come into effect May 2018. There are some significant changes to the regulations which will fundamentally change what we now call the Data Protection Act. And as I said, we are well underway planning for those changes.
Contractual arrangements allow us to out all of these little details will become an implementation plan, and part of that will be a comprehensive education and training program for members and for officers and anyone else that we're working in partnership with, to make sure that everybody is aware of who is responsible for doing what beyond the May 2018 cutover.
That was the answer I received from Chair.
Okay. Not this.
Yeah, I was going to ask earlier on about the data retrieval, but you adequately answered that, so that's great. But what you did say is that there's, on the very sensitive information, there will be a select number of people that will be able to have access to that. Okay? And I can understand the encryption and all that business. What strengthening of the legal around that with those few people that can access that very sensitive information? Are we doing anything about strengthening the legal responsibility of holding that information and disseminating that information? Because yes, the law is changing. Yes, there's strength in there. But I'm looking at the very few people that would have access to the very high sensitive stuff and what they do with it. Are we thinking about strengthening the legality around that? In other words, do they have to sign a document within the council to say that, you know, this is what you can do and this is what you can't do?
Even under the current arrangement of the Data Protection Act, there are clear responsibilities to be able to show who has access and for what purpose to that very sensitive information. We will continue to act in the using best practice and under the law. So if they require signatures and particular processes, they will be implemented within the council to make sure that we retain that position of legality. I wouldn't say that we will strengthen beyond the legal position. We will comply with the law, which is good, and we will do everything necessary to make sure that is in place.
Thank you, Mike. Christina.
Can I just ask, was there a confusion about 2019? Easily confused.
Yeah.
I thought if you put your information into paper form, you could still retain it for reference. Am I right?
I don't have that information, and as I said, we are currently going through the GDPR, the General Data Protection Regulations, and we are understanding all of the differences between our current arrangements and the future arrangements and planning around that.
Because otherwise it would make it quite difficult to have an ongoing case, because it can well last over 3 years.
Especially
when post I was dealing with Wirral Council.
Well, yeah, that is yes. That is something that we are looking at, as I said, not only here in Wirral, but within local government as a whole. The LGA have got a group looking at these things, and we are in contact with them. In fact, I sit on one of their national groups that are looking at the GDPR and the implications for local government, and there are similar groups looking at the implications from the NHS point of view and other parts of government. We will come back with definitive statements that say you can do this, you can't do that. We will distill what's in the regulation into as simple a document or a set of training as we possibly can. For everybody, because it's very complicated and it's so easy to actually fall foul if you don't get it absolutely right.
Mike, I can see why some councils will be quite worried about it. Imagine now that we completely destroy our case files, which we've got electronically, and then for 18 months' time, a member of the public phones us, fully expecting us to be absolutely au fait with the problem that we dealt with
particular